Thank you. Good day, everybody. Sorry about the slight whine there. That was the radio mic. John will be turning it down in a minute. For various reasons, technical and otherwise, this is actually a service recorded a few days in advance. So those of you who join us online, and we do value greatly, still have a service to join on Sunday morning. This Sunday morning is Remembrance Sunday, particularly across the Anglican Church of Britain and Ireland. And it's the reason we have this service each year, as you can see when John will put up the words on the screen, is on the 11th day of the 11th month, 11 a.m., in 1918, the guns fell silent on the First World War. Perhaps even to this day, one of the most horrific conflicts the world has ever seen. And so each year on the Sunday closest to the 11th of November, we have an act of remembrance, to remember those who died in the First World War and all wars. And so in Britain and Ireland and across Commonwealth countries, the symbol of that remembrance has and continues to be a red poppy. And the reason for that was that after the fields had been churned up by the shelling and the killing, the poppies seeded themselves and grew thousands, if not millions, of fields of Flanders, Belgium, and northern France. And the poppies were red, and it reminded them of the blood that was shed of so many people who died. I recognize that for some of you who join us online, this would not be your original tradition or the background you're from, but I think it's timely this year, not just because it is Remembrance Sunday, but what with the war in Ukraine and other parts of the world, it's sometimes appropriate to be challenged and to be a bit uncomfortable with the whole nature of war and the loss that people have felt. So this service is an act of remembrance and an act of worship. We begin with some words from Scripture. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. I lift up my eyes to the hills, from whence will my help come from? The Lord, who made heaven and earth. This I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. The gathering words of prayer. We are here to worship God, whose purposes are good, whose power sustains the world he has made, who loves us, though we have failed in his service, who gave Jesus Christ for the life of the world, who by his Spirit leads us in his way. As we thank him for his great works, we pray for all who suffer through war and the violence of even men. We ask for God's protection for those serving in peacekeeping, and for help and blessing that we might do his will, and we may acknowledge him as Lord and King. Our first hymn is All People That on Earth Do Dwell.
Oh,
Now we turn to a different part in the church, and you might notice behind me there are three wreaths, and they are placed there on Remembrance Sunday, in remembrance of those who died in the First World War and the Second World War. We now have a time of remembrance. We meet in the presence of God. We commit ourselves to work with penitence and faith for reconciliation between the nations, that all people may together live in freedom, justice, and peace. We pray for all who in bereavement, disability, and pain continue to suffer the consequences of fighting and terror. We remember with thanksgiving and sorrow those whose lives in world wars and conflicts past and present have been given and taken away. They shall not grow old as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them. We will remember them. And now we move to our act of remembrance and a time of silence. Ever-living God, we remember those whom you've gathered from the storm of war into the peace of your presence. May that same peace calm our fears, bring justice to all peoples, and establish harmony among the nations, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. God grant the living grace and the departed rest, the church, the state, and all people, unity, peace, and concord. And we will go to the blessing and that part actually later in the service. Amen. We now turn to our psalm, and that, as you can see, is the Lord's my shepherd. It's a newer version with the chorus, I will trust in you alone.
Thank you.
We now turn to the ministry of the word, and we begin with our reading from the Old Testament from the prophet Isaiah, chapter 2, beginning at verse 1. The word of Isaiah, son of Amos, concerning Judea and Jerusalem. In the days to come, the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established as the highest of the mountains, and shall be raised above the hills. All the nations shall stream to it. Many people shall come and say, "Come, let us go to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, that he may teach us his ways, and that we may walk in his paths." For out of Zion shall go forth instruction, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He shall judge between the nations, and shall arbitrate for many peoples. They shall beat their swords into plowshares, and their spears into pruning hooks. Nations shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war any more. O the house of Jacob, come, let us walk in the light of the Lord. And our next reading is from John's Gospel. Chapter 15, beginning at verse 9. As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. I have said these things to you so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do as what I command you. I do not call you servants any longer, because a servant does not know what the master is doing. But I have called you friends, because I have made known to you everything that I have heard from my Father. You did not choose me, but I chose you. And I appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, so the Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. I am giving these few commands so that you may love one another. This is the word, the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. I pray, Lord, now as we come to your word, you might open our ears, our eyes, our hearts, that we might know and hear and you more clearly, Jesus, in your name. Amen. Well, you might notice that the setting has changed slightly. Not only am I standing in the middle of the church, but we're using a different camera because the technical gremlins are at us this evening, and the other camera is suffering from condensation. So I wanted to just reflect on the different readings, and hopefully it'll help us to journey with God and allow him to speak with us. Beginning with the reading I gave from Isaiah. It speaks of the Lord's house on the mountain, and that it is a place where above the hills the nations shall gather. And they shall gather in not just with the Lord, but I believe in the ways of the Lord. Because it says that many people will come and say, "Come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of God of Jacob," and that he will teach them their ways, and he'll make their path straight. Let's be honest, both as individuals, as family, as community, and as nations, we do not always walk in the ways of God. And indeed, when we walk in our own ways, well, they do not always turn out kindly or graciously. But he says he will not judge between the nations. He shall judge actually between the nations and arbitrate for many peoples. But he speaks about a time yet to come when they beat their swords into plowshares, their spears into pruning hooks, and nation shall not rise up against nation, neither shall be war any more. Indeed, that's actually been turned into a gospel song. But it speaks of a time when God brings reconciliation, and that is the message of the gospel, that we are reconciled first to God, reckoned to ourselves, because we often are fighting within ourselves, reconciled within our families and our community. It's a progress, it's a beginning. The first step is to say yes to Jesus and yes to God. And as we are reconciled to him, he works out that in our lives. And it can take a whole life for that to be completed. But I'm sure you may well have come across a Christian who embodied that, who lived that out.
One who comes to mind is Gordon Wilson, who I was fortunate enough many years ago when he came to speak at the college I was attending in Carlow, and how he was able to forgive those who killed his daughter. And she was actually killed on Remembrance Day when they were standing remembering those who'd fallen. But because God had forgiven him, he then was able to forgive others. And I'm sure that was anything but easy, but he was trying, by God's good graciousness, God's unmerited strength and favor, to forgive others as he has been forgiven. So then we come to the last little few lines, few words of Isaiah's prophecy. And a prophecy is where God speaks to someone, and as they speak out God's words, he speaks into the situation that was, that's to come, and is yet to come. O house of Jacob, come, let us walk in the light of the Lord. They're not just walking in nice brightness, if you will. They're working in the glory and the ways of the Lord. So our prayer for today is that as we recall conflicts past, present, and I hope not future, that we would indeed walk in the ways of the Lord. The next thing is, I have a little picture there for us to share with you. This was a postcard that used to be in a little frame up in the corner of my grandma's kitchen. And I know it speaks about the new year, but I think it's very appropriate for today. Give me a light that I may tread safely into the unknown. And he replied, go out into the dark and put your hand into the hand of God. That shall be to you better than light and safer than the known way. Especially in times of conflict, but not just only then. I believe that oftentimes we can be, if you will, stumbling in the darkness. We have lost our way. And Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. So may we come back to Jesus and to his ways, especially when we lose our way individually and collectively, and it even comes to war. Now, I didn't read from the Romans reading because I'm going through all the different readings, but I'm just going to draw our attention to just a few things. And Paul is writing to the church in Rome, and he's encouraging them and challenging them. He's saying, if God is for us, who is against us? God has gone so far that he sent his own son, and that all who respond to him, as we heard in John's gospel, we become his elect, his people. And he uses a legal word of justifies. In other words, Jesus has paid for the wrong that we've done. He's got rid of the debt, got rid of the barrier, and the way to God is now open. And it was opened and to us in and through his cross, his death and resurrection. And now is at the right hand of the Father, praying in the Father's ear for you and for me. And if that being the case, as Paul believes it is, and I do too, then if that is our anchor, if you will, who can separate us? Yes, we will go through hardship, distress, persecution, famine, nakedness, sword, war. And yes, it is very challenging, and we may stumble and we may fall, and we need God's help, and perhaps there are times we need the help of other Christians to pick us up, even to carry us along. But Paul is saying that what is in heaven reaching out to us is that much stronger than that which we face. And he goes on to say we are more than conquerors because he has loved us, whether it's even death or life, whether angels in heaven, rulers on earth, things present, to come, powers, height, nor depth, anything else in all creation can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. And that's how I believe that God is, if you will, reaching out to us in and through and by his Son. And his Son reaches out to us now in the words of the commandments to love God and to love our neighbor. And so in a sense, now that he's reached out, do we put our hand into his hand and grasp his hand? Because he said that we must abide in love and that joy may complete together as we're reconciled to each other. That we love one another because God has first loved us, like Gordon Wilson as an example. And we're no longer servants, we are friends, we are friends with the Almighty. And we have been chosen by God, and God has done that for us before we even thought of him, let alone thought of responding. So I close with just one other image. Imagine there, if you will, that is God's hand reaching out to us. Do we put our hand into his hand? It's like as if he's reaching down, pulling us up, standing us up, rescuing us, and bringing us back to himself. And that is a message needed at all times, but especially when we think of conflict, where the reconciliation is often not there, and a rescue is needed. God has come to rescue us and redeem us. So now let us respond through words of repentance. These are written particularly for the service today. They are challenging, but sometimes God stretches us to bring us to a better place. So let us join in an act of penitence for our sins and our share in the sins of the world. And at each of them, we say at the end, Christ, have mercy. We have sinned against you and against our neighbor in what we've thought and what we've said, and of what we have done and what we have failed to do. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Just trying to find my place. We have been deaf to your call to serve Christ as Christ has served us. We have not been true to the mind of Christ. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. We confess to you, Lord God, the pride, the hypocrisy, the impatience in our lives. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. We confess our greed, our self-indulgence, our misuse of your gifts to us. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. We confess our envy of others, our selfish anger, our unloving thoughts and actions to our family, friends, and neighbors. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. We have wounded your love and marred your image in us. We are sorry and ashamed. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Accept our repentance, good Lord, for wrongs that we've done, for our blindness to human need and suffering, and for our indifference to injustice and cruelty. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Accept our repentance, good Lord. Forgive our sins of negligence and ignorance, as well as our deliberate sins. Grant us the grace of your Holy Spirit and time to amend our lives according to your holy word. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We come now to our next hymn, which speaks about faith from the Old Testament times through to Jesus and the times we are now.
In the light of rose, we prove his name.
I love that hymn. We now turn to prayer, and these are prayers of thanksgiving and intercession written especially for today and this service. So let us bring our petitions, intercessions, and thanksgivings before God. At the end of each prayer, I'll say, Lord, in your mercy, and if you could join in by saying, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for the wonders of your creation and for the gifts of human life and for the blessings of human fellowship within our families and our communities and in our nations. And we thank you for Christ, who's reconciling the world to yourself, your living word, through whom we have taught the way of life and the royalty of service to you and to each other. And for your Spirit, your Holy Spirit, who offers us gifts of love, of joy, of patience, of humility, of self-control, and more for the common good. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those of authority, for Michael D. Higgins, our president, for Micheál Martin, our Taoiseach, for members of the Dáil and the Seanad, the Oireachtas, for the county councillors. And we pray for our near neighbours in Northern Ireland, particularly in this time as they are without a government. We pray, Lord, that there be a resolution to the divisions and misunderstandings and other reasons that prevent them from coming together to form an assembly and a government. And we pray for our neighbours in the United Kingdom, for their new King, Charles, and for his family as they continue to mourn the loss of their mother and grandmother, Queen Elizabeth, and for the new Prime Minister and members of the Parliament there. We pray for leaders within our own land, our islands, and those round about would hear the crisis of our times, the crisis of tensions, the crisis of those who have more when those who have less are little, and for the conflicts that are on our own continent and lands right across this world. May they seek your will, your way, and your presence to be peacemakers. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our own nations and the nations round about us, particularly those nations that have influence. May they use their influence and power for the good and for the blessing of others, and not for destruction. We pray particularly for the conflict ongoing in the Ukraine between them and Russia, the ongoing tensions and outbreaks of violence in Palestine and Israel. For Africa, particularly Somalia, South Sudan and Sudan, Eritrea, and we give thanks that there seems to be talking between Ethiopia and Eritrea. And we pray for other places where there are conflict that we do not get to hear of, but you, Lord, know of. May there be peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We thank you for those who share your prophet's vision of Isaiah and of the other prophets, who spoke forth the word and the ways of God, of swords becoming plowshares, of spears becoming pruning hooks, of disarming nations and putting aside divisions, both between countries and within countries. May your words ring true and challenge hearts and minds. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all those who suffered as a result of war or civil strife, and for those particularly who are maimed in body and in mind, and for those after such conflicts and divisions find it near impossible to take part in family life or enjoy normal friendships and fellowships. Would you be with them in a powerful and peaceful way, and may you bring alongside them help that is needed. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We thank you for those many who work with those who are suffering torture, torment, or other kinds of violence upon the body and upon the person of men and of women. And we thank you for so many who give so graciously and so generously to bring healing in mind, body and spirit, would you strengthen those who help to give strength to others. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who seek to make peace and bring reconciliation, where there's prejudice, hatred, bitterness and division. We pray especially for the peacekeepers, particularly of the UN, and those Irish soldiers who are in Lebanon and other parts of the world. And we thank you for those people within communities, within lands, who often never make the news, but yet work tirelessly and quietly to bring reconciliation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we thank you, Lord, for your church, your people, the elect. We thank you that you've given us good news of this gospel. May we take heed of this gospel. May we, by your Spirit, live out this gospel and proclaim the message of love and peace to you and between us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for men and women, boys and girls, everywhere, may be able to live in freedom and fellowship of your kingdom as you have intended it to be. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And this collect, as we bring our prayers towards a close. Almighty God, you called your church to witness that you were in Christ reconciling the world to yourself. Help us to proclaim the good news of your love, that all who hear it may be reconciled to you through him who died and rose again and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Gathering all our prayers and praises into one, as our Saviour Christ has taught us, we're bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We come now to our final hymn for our service today. Very appropriate for this today, and a well-known one for Remembrance Sunday. God, our strength and refuge, may he that be that today and in the week to come. Service draws to a close. You might notice I'm back in my usual spot. The fog has cleared. So we've been trying to reach you this day through digital means, which some have worked smoothly and some haven't. But unfortunately, such is life. But we go with the closing words to comfort and strengthen us. Lord, in your mercy, if you'd like to join us saying this with me. Almighty God, we pledge ourselves anew to be peacemakers in our homes, in our community, in our country, and throughout the world. Lord God, guide us by your Spirit, give us wisdom, give us courage, give us hope, and keep us faithful, now and always. Amen. To the King of Ages, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honour and glory forever. Amen. God grant to the living grace, to the departed rest, and to the Church and to the nations peace and concord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you this day and evermore. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.